Very good morning to all participants who are joining this e-lecture through distant locations. So I will be talking about monitoring of the Earth's atmosphere, opportunities and challenges. So this is really a very interesting subject that I'm going to talk, and I have kept this lecture very much lucid and to the basic level, as we understand that students from undergraduate and graduate level are, I think, are interested in this. So that's why I'll be just focusing on very basic things and very simple, which everyone can follow. So now, as the topic, you can see that monitoring the Earth's atmosphere. So the first question comes that what is basically the atmosphere, and then we come to the Earth, and then how does it deal with other issues? So Earth's atmosphere. Next. So this is the outline of my talk, basically. I'll be talking about the existence of the atmosphere on the planet, on any planet, basically, that what are the factors governing the atmosphere on the on a planet, and then classification and various layers in the atmosphere of Earth, basically, and special emphasis to the Earth, because we are living on the Earth, so we have to be very much aware and have some knowledge about the Earth's atmosphere. Then why and what to monitor on the surface of the Earth, basically, as far as the atmosphere of the Earth is concerned. Then what are the various tools to monitor atmospheric parameters, and why these parameters are to be monitored. Then what are the extreme weather events, and then I'll be talking about a special event that usually take place, extreme weather event in the Himalayan region, and we call it cloudburst. So I'll be just giving some focus on this aspect also. Now, atmospheric observing facilities at Aries, since Aries is mainly meant for that astronomical and related studies, but then we have a small section here which deals with atmospheric observing facilities and then atmospheric studies. Then finally, I'll be just trying to explain or try to, get the students familiar with the opportunities available in India and abroad. And then finally, what are the challenges in atmospheric sciences where the students can really be prepared for their future activities and can contribute to the atmospheric related issues. So what is atmosphere? The simplest possible definition that we see as far as the Earth is concerned is that the atmosphere is a shallow layer of gaseous mixture which is enveloping this globe, and which is having the thickness of, say, about 1% of the radius of the Earth. And then the presence of the atmosphere protects us from the harmful radiations which are there present in the atmosphere and coming from the sun, basically, which is the source of the energy. And then this is also equally important that the only known planet on the solar system or in our universe where life is sustained is known, which is known, is Earth. So we have to learn a little more about the atmosphere on the surface of the Earth, and then what are the structure and how the phenomenon in the atmosphere takes place, and what are the importance of all these basic things. So the existence of the atmosphere. So we have basically two governing factors which decides that what is the what are the I mean how the atmosphere, what are the factors that decide the presence of an atmosphere on a planet which are basically known to us, say our solar system. So the governing factors are temperature present on the surface of a planet, and then acceleration due to the gravity. So the temperature present on the surface, or the surface temperature, or we can say the temperature overall, the mean temperature of a planet, will decide the motion or the velocity of the molecules or the gases or any composition present on the planet of the on that planet. So if the temperature, for example, of a planet is very high, so in that case, we actually have to see whether, I mean, the kind of the gases which are present on the surface of the Earth will sustain to this temperature, or that their velocity will go so high that they will escape the planet. So the first factor is the temperature of that planet. And then second factor is acceleration due to gravity, because the acceleration due to gravity is the only force that is holding anything which is any material which is surrounding the planet or Earth or so, or anything else where we can imagine that atmosphere can exist. So the second factor is the acceleration due to gravity, which basically try to hold the gaseous envelope or the fluid on the surface of that planet. So now, if you see the mathematical relation, how the temperature and the velocity of a molecule or a gas molecule is associated, this is basically your velocity. Just go back. No, this one, yeah, but this is, no, this one. And then velocity of a molecule, as I just said, that it is decided by the temperature of that planet. So as from this formula, you can see if the temperature is really high, so the velocity of that gas molecule will be very high, correspondingly high. Or, and then again, the escape velocity, another factor is the escape velocity. So escape velocity, basically, if you see here, the escape velocity of a planet is given by this relation, where g is acceleration due to gravity and r is the radius of that planet. So this is basically to have the existence of an atmosphere on a planet, there is a balance between these two, you know, forces. Basically, we can say the velocities, and if the gravitational pull which is holding that mass or the gas on that planet is very, very high, then the velocity of this the molecule which is caused by the temperature, I mean the velocity which is caused by the temperature goes higher than the escape velocity, so it will simply leave the that planet, and there will not be any atmosphere. So for example, if we think of Sun, its escape velocity is extremely high. So if any gaseous molecule have to escape the Sun, so the velocity, escape velocity, has to be 618 kilometer per second. For example, the escape velocity of Earth is 11.2 kilometer per second. Now, so again, going to the end. Okay. Just to, because there's some suddenly jumping. Yeah. So if we try to compare the, the atmospheric the parameters of like escape velocity and then molecule and the temperature of the planet in the solar system, then we can see there here that the closest temperature on the surface of the Mars, the temperature which is closest to the average temperature of the Earth, is the temperature that we have on the surface of the Mars, basically. And that's why there have been so many missions planned by the various countries globally, which basically are planned to find out the actual atmosphere and the possibility of life on Mars, because of the only region that the temperature at the Mars and the composition of the atmosphere there is more or less close to the atmosphere on the surface of the Earth. So if you see here that Earth, the mean temperature of the Earth is around 20 degrees Celsius, and the escape velocity, as I told you, that it is 11.2 kilometer per second, and बस ऐसे क्यों हो रहा है बार बार? आप कुछ कर रहे हो? या सो इफ यू सी द सरफेस टेम्परेचर ऑफ मर्करी इज 350 डिग्री सेल्सियस इन डे टाइम. सो द सरफेस टेम्परेचर इज वेरी वेरी हाई. सो एनी गैसेस मॉलिक्यूल विच वी आर लुकिंग फॉर अ पॉसिबिलिटी देयर विल बी हैविंग वेरी हाई वेलोसिटी एंड विच विल एक्सीड द बेसिकली द एस्केप वेलोसिटी ऑफ द प्लैनेट एंड लीव द प्लैनेट. सो देर इज़ नो एटमोसफियर. सो दिस इज बेसिकली द कॉन्सेप्ट दैट हाउ वी डिसाइड अपॉन द पॉसिबिलिटी ऑफ एटमोसफियर ऑन अ प्लैनेट. एट द सेम टाइम इफ यू सी द जुपिटर, सैटर्न, यूरेनस, नेपच्यून एंड अदर प्लैनेट्स, द टेम्परेचर, द सर्फेस टेम्परेचर इज़ वेरी वेरी लो. सो सर्फेस टेम्परेचर बींग वेरी लो, देन द एस्केप वेलोसिटी आर वेलोसिटीज आर रियली हाई एट दोज प्लैनेट्स बेसिकली. एंड देन द गैसेस कंपोजिशन, इफ यू सी हेयर दैट मार्स इज हैविंग अराउंड 95% CO2, विच इज बेसिकली अ गैस दैट दैट इज रिक्वायर्ड टू कीप द सर्फेस ऑफ द अर्थ वार्मर एंड टू आई मीन अ पॉसिबिलिटी इन टर्न टू हैव द सस्टेनेबिलिटी ऑफ लाइफ. एंड बट देन ऑक्सीजन, द अमाउंट ऑफ ऑक्सीजन इज़ वेरी वेरी लो, विच इज़ आई मीन फॉर लिविंग विंग्स, विच इज़ वन ऑफ द इम्पोर्टेंट कॉम्पोनेंट. नाउ इफ यू सी, नाउ वी कम टू द अर्थ्स एटमोसफेयर. नाउ सो द अर्थ एटमोसफेयर बेसिकली द क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ द अर्थ एटमोसफेयर इज बेस्ड ऑन टू फैक्टर्स. वन इज द बेस्ड ऑन द कंपोजिशन, द अदर इज द बेस्ड ऑन द थर्मल स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द एटमोसफेयर. सो द कंपोजिशन इज बेसिकली द गैसेज कंपोजिशन. वट वी टॉक अबाउट दैट देर आर सर्टिन गैसेज ऑन द सर्फेस ऑफ द अर्थ विच आर गुड फॉर विच आर एक्चुअली नेसेसरी फॉर द सर्वाइवल ऑफ लिविंग विंग्स. फॉर एग्जाम्पल ऑक्सीजन, देन नाइट्रोजन एंड सम अदर गैसेज इन ट्रेस अमाउंट्स विच ऑल्सो हैव वेरी सीरियस इम्पैक्ट्स एंड आई मीन काइंड ऑफ पैरामाउंट इम्पॉर्टेंस. सो द बेस्ड ऑन द टेम्परेचर, द थर्मल स्ट्रक्चर इज अनदर पैरामीटर दैट बेस्ड ऑन दैट वी डिफाइन द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द एटमोसफेयर. सो द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन दैट कम्स इन अवर माइंड इफ आई आस्क यू नो विच इज़ नॉट हैविंग एनी आइडिया अबाउट द एटमोसफेयर, इफ आई आस्क 10 पीपल दैट वट इज द एक्सटेंट ऑफ द एटमोसफेयर दैट वी कैन इमेजिन इन द वर्टिकल, दैट हाउ हाई द एटमोसफेयर विल बी प्रिवेलिंग एंड वी कैन हैव द सर्वाइवल ऑफ लाइफ. सो देन 10 पीपल विल हैव डिफरेंट 10 डिफरेंट आंसर्स. So that's why we need to understand that what are the basically different structure layers in the atmosphere. So I'll be talking more about that. So this is basically based on the composition. So the as we know that our atmosphere is consisting of 78% of nitrogen, then 21% oxygen, and 1% other gases, which includes argon, carbon dioxide, water vapor, and then many other inert gases. But then this 1% composition of the atmosphere plays big role, you know, in various activities related to or various processes related to the atmosphere or weather or the climate. For example, the concentration of carbon dioxide here, if you see that it is 380 parts per million. Right, so parts per million means in 1 million of if we collect 1 million of the molecules of air, then you will find that there will be only out of 380 parts you will find one part of carbon dioxide. So this is I mean how these trace elements have huge contribution and impact on the atmospheric composition. That if we see that last 100 years, the temperature, the concentration of the carbon dioxide has gone up by 40%. And we know that carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas, and it basically traps the incoming solar radiation in the lower part of the atmosphere and heats it up, and then ultimately give rise to the temperature of the Earth. And this rising temperature we call basically the global warming. So then these trace elements like ozone, oxides of nitrogen, methane, carbon dioxide are all trace gases and basically are the trace elements and which have significant contribution on or significant impact on the weathers and weather related issues and the climatic implications. So now the second one is based on the thermal structure of the atmosphere. So the thermal structure of the atmosphere basically, as we talk that this the composition of the atmosphere, what we have been talking is the measurement of the species that we make on the surface of the Earth, because we cannot go higher up and make all sort of measurements there and then try to explain that what is the composition. And as we know that as we go up into the atmosphere, the atmospheric density decreases by exponentially, like rho is equal to rho naught e raised to power minus z by h. Similarly, the pressure also goes down by exponentially in the vertical, because most of the air mass or the composition of the atmosphere is confined in the lower most portion of the atmosphere. So now the atmosphere in the vertical, as I asked that, if I ask 10 people, so 10 people will have different 10 different answers. So that is where we have to understand that what is the vertical structure of the atmosphere. So atmosphere in the vertical is defined or divided by the layers. So, and there are four major layers. We call them troposphere, stratosphere, mesosphere, and the thermosphere. And these layers vary from one latitude to the other latitude, or basically from tropical region to mid-latitude to the polar regions in different way. So layers in the atmosphere are defined by temperature, when we call the thermal structure of the atmosphere. So in the troposphere, if you see, the lowermost part is the troposphere. So troposphere in the tropics basically extends from surface to about 16 to 18 kilometer in the tropics. This is a general picture, I mean, which maybe, you know, on an average picture, which may be true for all, you know, taking the average of all geographical regions. So if you see that troposphere extends up to, this is here, it's about 10 kilometer, but this is not for the tropics. If we talk about tropics, the troposphere is up to about 16 to 18 kilometer. And then stratosphere starts from 18 kilometers, so up to 50 to 53 kilometers in the vertical. And then there are layers in between, some stable layers in between, one from one sphere to the other sphere, we call them pauses basically. Where the other layer starts, there is a pause in between, say of about 1 to 2 kilometers, where the temperatures are almost constant. And we call them pause. So where the troposphere ends and the stratosphere begins is basically tropopause. And then similarly, the stratosphere, the boundary between the stratosphere and the mesosphere is stratopause. And then stratosphere starts from 53 kilometers, say about 90 kilometer, and from 90 kilometer onwards up to around 600 kilometers is the thermosphere. And then after 600 kilometers, we call that exosphere, say simply basically the space. And if you I mean, as we know that most of the satellite activities or satellite launches are kept beyond this 600 kilometer, whether these are or somewhere between 400 to 600 kilometer, because this is almost kind of having no gases, or only the molecules, very ionized molecules are there, and that too very far away. And the, if we talk about the collisions between two molecules, so it will be almost 1 kilometer or that, more than that. So how the temperature goes up. So now we come to the temperature point. So in the troposphere, if you see, the temperature is consistently decreasing up to the tropopause. So the temperature in the troposphere decreases because the density decreases and then the pressure decreases, and then the pressure and then temperature are related. So if the first thing, the low density, low pressure will ultimately lead to the lower temperature. And moreover, the atmosphere is heated from the below, not from the above. The incoming solar radiation, which is reaching to the surface of the earth in the visible form, is absorbed by the surface of the earth and then re-radiated into the outgoing long wave radiation. And that outgoing long wave radiation is in turn trapped by the atmospheric compositions in different wavelengths, for example, water vapor, carbon dioxide, and many more. And then finally, it increases the temperature of the air molecules. And then finally, that gives us basically the feel of the warmth and the cold kind of thing. So if you see the in the troposphere, the temperature decreases by 6.5 degrees Celsius per kilometer. And we call it a lapse rate of the atmosphere. So this can be understood from the analogy that one who is staying at Trivandrum, Calcutta, Delhi, or Mumbai, if they come straightway to a hill station, they feel, you know, all of a sudden very cold, very kind of pleasant, and they feel that the climate is the temperature is very pleasant. So this is basically the reason that the temperature, as we go above from mean sea level in the atmosphere, the temperature basically decreases. And this is in case of troposphere. And the temperature goes up to, say, tropopause, around up to minus 2-3 degrees Celsius. No, even more than that. We can say 16 degree will be more than 40-50 degrees Celsius. And then the temperature start increasing in the stratosphere because the stratospheric composition is different from the troposphere. So stratosphere is dominated by the ozone gas, and ozone gas basically absorbs almost all ultraviolet radiation which is coming towards the earth, and this increases the kinetic energy and in turn the temperature of the stratosphere. So this rise in the temperature in the stratosphere is basically due to the presence of the ozone gas in the stratosphere. However, in troposphere also we have these trace gases, as we discussed in the earlier slide, that on the trace amount of ozone is also present in the troposphere, but that amount in the troposphere is treated as pollutant. You know, if it crosses some limits, there are standards for all the gases, for CO2, for ozone, somewhere between 30 to 50 ppb for ozone. So, and then there are limits. If it goes beyond a limit in the troposphere, so it is treated as pollutant, and also at the same time increases the temperature of the lower part of the atmosphere. And then the stratosphere, again the temperature goes up, but it doesn't come even close to the zero. So the temperature always remains negative. Increasing means temperature is still below zero. And then if we see here that in the mesosphere, again the temperature starts going down. And then after the mesopause, when in the thermosphere, the temperature consistently goes rising and higher up in the atmosphere. So these now this mesosphere and thermosphere, basically the boundary between this is mesopause. So the upper portion of the mesosphere and some lower portion of the thermosphere constitute another sphere called ionosphere, and which is another entire field of research. It opens a new area of research, basically, if we talk about the ionosphere. So all these spheres have their own importance in the vertical and their distribution. They have different compositions. Like in the mesosphere, if you see, most of the lighter gases are in the form of ionized particles, ionized form. So they have electron and then ions basically, and that's why we call it ionosphere, or some thermosphere also the part of ionosphere. So then now if you see that as I told that density and pressure decreases exponentially with altitude, and the matter of fact is that 99% of the atmospheric mass lies between below 40 kilometer, and that too if you talk about then 75% of the air mass is within say troposphere within 18 kilometer, and almost 99% water vapor and these particles which we call aerosols, which are suspended in the atmosphere ranging from say nanometer to of the order of micrometer size, these are also all present in the troposphere, and all weather phenomena, everything, all climate change issues take place in the troposphere itself. So most of the weather processes, as mentioned here also, take place in the troposphere. Now these are some of the salient features of troposphere. Troposphere contains approximately 80% of the atmospheric mass and 99% of this water vapor of the and aerosols. And then stratosphere is stratified in temperature with warmer layers higher up and cooler layers farther down. So these are very and then mesosphere is the coldest temperature at the mesopause, about somewhere around minus 100 degrees Celsius. And then thermosphere constitutes ionosphere, which is conducive for the radio communication. So now we come to this ionosphere, which I was talking about, that this is the upper boundary of the mesosphere and lower of the thermosphere. And this extends from 60 kilometer to about 180 kilometer. And then, as I told that this is a new, another subject of study, which basically then classifies this again, this sphere in different layers, the D layer, E layer and F layer. So in the daytime, this D layer comes from the daytime when the sun is present, and this is starting from somewhere 60 kilometer to up to 120 kilometer, then 120 to 180 kilometer is your E layer, then F layer comes beyond 180 kilometer. So these are the further classification of ionosphere. Now, as we are talking about the monitoring of Earth's atmosphere, so why the monitoring of any atmosphere basically is essential, that we have actually understood in the previous discussion, that once we have the atmosphere, then there is a possibility of, we look for the possibility of the life, and as I told that only known planet where the possibility of life is the surface of the Earth, or the Earth is the planet, and then there are the parameters which affects us from day-to-day life, and these are the basically crucial parameters that we need to monitor, and in order to understand the atmospheric processes, and so that all sort of activities which are driven by human being can be kept a watch on, that are we really harming it, or we are contributing towards it positively or negatively, and why we need to monitor and what are the changes. So these are the parameters if we talk about the atmospheric science, that we first we understand that anywhere we go, so the first thing we talk about the weather. So people understand weather means the temperature simply, and then of course cloud and rain. So the first parameter that we need to understand is basically the atmospheric temperature pressure. Pressure is of course one parameter, because it gives us the information right from the mean sea level to understand the vertical structures, and the movement of the winds, the changes in the pressure, and which are caused by the temperature, then air temperature, and then humidity of the air, because humidity is also again another important parameter, which is basically a driving force for many bacterial activity survivals, and many things which are transmitted through viruses, bacteria, and all those things. So humidity is also another parameter. And of course, for other atmospheric or other species which are surviving on the earth, then rainfall, wind, and clouds. And so these are the very essential six parameters that basically we, whenever we talk about the weather, then we have to understand all these parameters. Then of course, visibility is another parameter which may not be directly affecting our survival, but then of course our other activities like commercial activities and aviation activities, these also depend upon the visibilities. And visibility is measured sensually. There are instruments called visiometer, transmissometer. So various techniques are available there to make the measurement of these this quantity called visibility. And then of course weather phenomenon we need to monitor from time to time, like planning our day-to-day activities or the future activities or agriculture things. So these weather parameters are important, weather phenomena like thunderstorms, lightning, heavy rains, cloudbursts, etc. So all these weather phenomena affect our life in a very significant way or very drastic way sometimes, and we call them extreme weather events. Like cloudburst is one of the serious concern of Himalayan region if we talk about it. And then of course waves, if you have to study the atmosphere, there are a number of oscillations in the atmosphere which are existing naturally, resulting from the mean flow, resulting from the gravitational forces, you can say, like if there are oscillations due to buoyant forces and which are driven by the solar radiation, then there are sort of waves which are produced in the atmosphere, and those waves also form our atmospheric phenomenon. So now what are the measuring tools of all these factors, as we discussed in the previous slide, that we can monitor the atmosphere or entire atmosphere based on these three methods. Basically, one is the ground-based method, which may be having fixed sensors, radars, lidars. These are basically radars and lidars are the remote sensing devices, but the active remote sensors which are operated from the ground as well as from the space. But then ground-based observations, basically we talk about the surface temperature. So then we have to put a thermometer of any working on any technology, we have to put it in a laboratory or in a room, so it will give us the temperature where we are staying or where we are living. So then we have these fixed sensors for not only for this temperature, pressure, humidity or wind, but also for many other atmospheric compositions which are in the form of the solid pollutants, like your aerosols if you talk about. So we need to monitor dust, aerosols, particulate matter, which are very harmful, black carbon, all these things which are very harmful or sometimes leading to very kind of difficult situations in mega cities, which are originating mainly from the pollutants. So all these are basically ground-based measurements which are essentially required and need to be set for the measurements of day-to-day levels of all these things. Then in-situ measurements are basically for example, the parameters that we can monitor from the surface is one part. But then if you want to know the same parameter, what is happening below our house, say our house is 20 meter tall, and then we can go on the roof top, so we can make the measurements only up to that level of the top of our roof. But if we have to kind of find out the information about the similar parameters at just above your roof, so you can't simply go above that. So for that we have to design the devices so that we can launch them, release them, and then these devices can provide us information right from the point where we want to get it from, and it keeps us transmitting the values at different locations in the vertical. So these are, we call them, these are basically balloon born initially when these things started, but then later the replacement have come for these measurements as well. So the pilot balloon is one of them, and the very early kind of situations in very early times when there was no other techniques available, like radio transmission kind of thing. So that time pilot balloon used to be released for the measurements of the wind. For example, if you want to know the upper circulation, say somewhere between 4 to 6 kilometer, because at surface we have wind vanes or a station which can monitor the winds at 10 meter at the surface. But if you have to make the measurements of the winds above, say 10 meter or say 100 meter, 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer, and so on. So that time balloons used to be released, and these balloons are called pilot balloons. But these balloons could not give other than wind any other information than the wind. So these were basically utilized for the winds. And then later, with the invention of the devices which can be attached to the balloon and released into the atmosphere, these devices basically were called radio sonde, we call them. Or then tethered balloons are also the similar devices which in situ means which can go there and make the measurements and tell us what is the temperature at say 1 kilometer in the vertical. And then of course nowadays these unmanned drones also are having capabilities. They can also be attached with some devices, like we talk about radio sonde, and released, sent in the vertical up to say few kilometers, and then get back to the surface of the earth after collecting some useful data. And these also again cannot be released frequently, and this will give just a snapshot of the atmosphere at one time. And whereas we need continuous information for various atmospheric processes, or to understand the various atmospheric processes, for example, if we talk about climatic change, and then if you want to deal with the climate change issues, we need long-term data. So all those continuous data. So for that, and then moreover, if we have very difficult terrain, for example, like Himalayas and many other deserts like Tibetan plateaus or other deserts of North African countries. So there, it is very difficult to go and put some laboratories and make the measurements. So that is where the role of these space when born measurements comes into picture, and we call we employ them very efficiently to get the informations, even that frequently, but still there are technologies and satellites which can give us a very high resolution, say 2 observations in a day, to say up to 1 observation, some of the satellites giving 1 observation in 14 to 15 days. So, but then we have basically these space-borne technologies available with us nowadays and getting improved with time, and being employed very efficiently for monitoring the globe as a whole. And then, of course, once we have all these informations, data available from the surface or the ground-based observations, in-situ measurements, and then satellite-based observations, then finally, what is the challenge before us is that we have to model these, we have to put these data sets into models, atmospheric models, which are nothing but the set of the some equations, and then solved numerically. So nowadays numerical modeling has become so popular in past 2 decades. If you see that the modeling situation has improved globally, particularly in Indian context, we talk, we have come far ahead what we had 2 decades ago. So all this could be possible only when we have observations available from all these 3 methodologies and tools. So some modeling, again, the modeling the atmospheric phenomenon is a challenging issue, and scientists from the globe as well as from Indian scientist communities or institutions are working on that these issues very rigorously. So this is pilot balloon, as I told you, that just to have a feel that a balloon, a meteorological balloon we call it, is filled with hydrogen or helium, which is lighter than basically air, and then released into the atmosphere. But this pilot balloon was tracked with the optical device called theodolite. It is having two scales, vertical and horizontal. So, and this tracks the position coordinates of this balloon, and the rate of change of this position coordinates basically will give you the wind speed and direction. So this was the earliest devices which were employed for monitoring the wind. But then here we cannot monitor the or get the vertical profile of the temperature, pressure, humidity, and any other parameter. Then the radio sonde, if you see, this is basically a typical package of radio sonde, which is having all sort of the sensor. This is one antenna, which is used for the transmission of the measured parameters, in situ measured parameters. It is having a pressure sensor, GPS receiver, temperature sensor, humidity sensor, and this is driven by a battery. And this will be continuously, these sensor will be sensing the in situation values of these parameters and continuously transmitting to the ground station, which is tuned with this radio sonde. So this is one snapshot from Aries. Aries people launching balloons into the atmosphere. And this is a package. This is in addition to radio sonde, is having ozone sonde as well. And we get a vertical profile of this temperature, pressure, humidity, and ozone as well. And wind speed and wind direction, because it is having GPS also. So this is how we make the vertical measurement of the upper air atmosphere. Now, if we talk about, as I was discussing, that we have some ground-based remote sensing devices. We call them radars or lidars, because we send some power into the atmosphere, electromagnetic signal. It gets back scattered through various mechanisms, which a particular system is sensitive for. And then we infer the relevant information about the atmosphere. So these are kind of the radars. If you talk, this is India Meteorological Department's Doppler weather radars, which is basically scanning radar and looking up to about 400 to 500 kilometer in the horizontal. So that's how we come to know that a cyclone is originating, how it is moving, and where it will reach. So these precise informations are nowadays available only because of the devices like these radars, which are being operated by Met Meteorological Departments of almost all countries. And then this is for clouds. If you see, this is another picture of a radar, that this will be scanning but pointed vertically basically, and looking for the clouds around the site or over the, you know, observational site. So this is a picture from the Doppler weather radar. How does it look like? If you want, this is also again to monitor the cloud and the rains basically. For example, in monsoon, if you see, this is the recent picture of the yesterday's picture. If you see, this is from Delhi. So Delhi Doppler radar is able to see around 150 kilometer. If you see, this, the outer circle is of 100 kilometer, 150 kilometer. This one is 100 kilometer, and then this is 50 kilometers. So here you can see, this is basically the reflectivity which is coming from the clouds. So the clouds are present, but not that dense clouds here. But if you see in this region, southwest region, the clouds are approaching from, we can say, from the way of Arabian Sea sites and coming towards the mainland. If we go towards more southwestern side. So this is another picture from our Indian satellite Kalpana. Here, as I was telling, that the clouds are prevailing all over the Indian peninsula region, and you know the direction basically for this southwesterly winds, whatever we actually see in the monsoon season. Now as I was telling, that this is one of the issues nowadays, our challenge, that we are having number of monitoring activities of the atmosphere, but still we are not able to predict well in advance the short scale phenomenon like extreme weather events, which comes suddenly, say within few hours to less than a day, and make a very huge impact on the lives of human, and of course on the nature as well. So these extreme weather events are basically classified into these many, the circle of influence. You can see here that extreme weather events comes in the form of the dust storms and the gust, which are associated with the strong winds and forest fires sometime. Then cyclones are also associated with the winds, which are damaging, basically very intense rainfall, tidal waves, and then of course persistent fog is also kind of extreme weather event. Then it stops all sort of activities and lead to many accidents in winter sometime. If you see it, that when there is a dense cover of fog in the Gangetic Plain, there are severe issues of health, and of course there's all commercial activities. And then extreme weather events also is associated with severe rainstorms, hot and cold waves. Hot waves basically in the summertime when the temperature goes beyond 45 degrees Celsius, and mostly if we often hear that in the North Indian region the heat wave is prevailing, and then of course similarly it happens in the winter also. So these are extreme weather events. Of course, heavy snow and avalanches are of course seen in the regions like Himalayas and even other mountain regions of the Europe and US, where these heavy snowfalls and avalanches also take place. But then I would just like to throw some light on the cloudburst in the Himalayan region, which is because we live here, and this is one of the devastating phenomenon which comes very fast, and within 1 hour or so it washes out everything and leaves severe effect behind. And then of course severe thunderstorms are of sometime associated with the tornadoes, hailstorms, lightning, and causing a lot of damage to the property and life as well. So now these extreme weather events basically in the past few decades, if we talk about these extreme weather activities, are increasing, and it is considered that the role of anthropogenic activities is playing major role, and it is contributing to the degradation of air quality, global warming, stratospheric ozone depletion, etc. And this global warming also in turn then boosting the atmospheric dynamics, and if you see in the past few decades, the temperature is also consistently going up. Extreme weather events, the frequency of the extreme weather events is increasing. Number of rainy days are decreasing, whereas the amount of rain is remaining same. So it means the rain intensity has increased and the drop size also have increased, and this is again leading to extreme weather events. So this is you can see that in IPCC 2013 reports, here we can see that the decades of 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and consistently up to 2000, and this is up to 2012, the temperature anomalies are increasing, and basically positive anomalies. So means that the temperature anomalies are basically the deviation from the mean temperature, and on a climatic scale. And if you see that in earlier, starting from say 1850 to 1915, in the span of 100 years, there have been episodes of positive and negative anomalies. But after 60s, the temperature has been consistently increasing. So which is an alarming situation, and for the globe and the, for the world. And this rise in temperature, which is caused by so-called greenhouse effect or the anthropogenic activities, have basically led to many extreme events in the past few decades, and the frequency of these events. So if we talk about the Himalayan context, the cloudburst is one of the severe or extreme weather event that occurs almost every year in the Himalayan region. But here we have just I would just like to talk about the cases which we have been witnessing for past few decades in the Uttarakhand only. However, Himachal Pradesh, J&K and the northeastern Himalayan states also face these extreme weather events and cloudburst. So cloudburst is a very rapid and quick phenomenon that creates a very severe impact and devastation, and we call these sometimes downpours. And these are very small scale sudden weather events, say within say 10 kilometer it happens, or even less than 10 kilometer area, and within say 1 hour, and it creates a huge damage. So the standard definition of cloudburst is that when the rain rate is about 100 millimeter per hour and the raindrop sizes are greater than 3.5 millimeters. So this situation is basically termed as cloudburst. And then most cloudbursts come from this convective systems, basically very when there is a strong convection. And of course, apart from the convection, because convection takes place almost everywhere. So, but then we have to have a supporting mechanism as far as these cloudbursts are concerned. And as we are aware that mostly the cloudburst events take place only in the mountain regions. These events do not occur at places like, if you talk about Bengaluru, Delhi, or any other places, because even the temperature is very high, and the convection is also equally stronger, even stronger than, but still we do not have the cloudburst. These cloudburst events occur only in the mountain regions, because the moist air which is coming from, you know, either of the systems, whether western disturbances or the monsoon, so these get lifted through the mountain slopes. And if there is strong slightly higher temperatures and getting lift, the moist air is lighter than the dry air, so it very easily lifts up and gets piled up in a region where it is trapped. Basically, if there is not sufficient kind of ventilation or horizontal flow which can take the clouds away from the site, then it will heap up there and keep forming clouds. We call them cumulonimbus clouds. So this convection will keep leading up the formation of these cumulonimbus clouds, and ultimately these clouds basically piles up and forms tall cumulonimbus. Now the mechanism how this cloudburst happens, because the simplest mechanism, thunderstorm also is a cumulonimbus cloud, but then thunderstorm is not that devastating as a cloudburst. So what happens that the mountain basically, as I told, that the orographic lifts give rise to the formation of these very thick heavy clouds, and the volume of the water inside the clouds keeps on increasing. But then there is always a balance between the gravity and buoyancy. Gravity, we try to bring it down, and then the buoyant forces which is being provided by the orography of the mountain or the valleys will keep it holding up and keep adding the moisture into the that cloud again. So whenever these cumulonimbus clouds form, there is always a kind of updrafts and downdrafts within the clouds, and the temperature gradients is also there. So these droplets also keep growing, and then the coalescing and the mixing process inside the clouds also goes on, and it keeps on growing the size of the droplet. So then one situation comes when it cannot hold the gravitational, these buoyant forces cannot hold the clouds up aloft in the atmosphere, and then all of a sudden these droplets starts falling like sudden in the form of the sudden downburst, and as you know that the situation is really worst when there is 100 millimeter rain per hour, so then it washes out everything away. So these are some of the examples starting from 1970 that have updated data up to 2016. And there have been a very severe episode. One is in July 1970, and then दिस जून 2013 14 टू 15 जून इवेंट ऑफ केदारनाथ वैली इफ यू सी दैट द लॉस ऑफ द लाइफ वॉज अराउंड 10,000 विच वॉज ऑफिशियली क्लेम्ड एंड देन इवन मोर देन दैट माइट हैव मोर देन मोर पीपल माइट हैव लॉस्ट देयर लाइव्स एंड देन इफ यू सी दैट एवरी ईयर ऑलमोस्ट देर आर विच आर रिपोर्टेड एक्चुअली देर आर इवेंट्स ऑफ द क्लाउड बस्ट एंड इन एवरी इवेंट देर इज लॉस ऑफ लाइफ एंड प्रॉपर्टी सो दिस इज द सिचुएसन विच वॉज बिफोर एंड आफ्टर यू नो द क्लाउड बस्ट और द हैवी रेन्स फॉर 3 days which we consider as a extreme weather event, unusual event, took place in the Kedarnath Valley and it washed away everything in the valley just around the temple and even below that, you know, the along the downstream, the towns and many houses were washed out and loss of property and lives and animals, everything was there. So now the biggest challenge is nowadays, if we talk about the Himalayan situation, is that it is very difficult to predict these cloudbursts in the Himalayan region. So the forecasting and warning of these events is very difficult and for that, as I told that these are the challenges that we need to address through various means, whether observations, modeling, and where the students may look as an opportunity or a challenge that these systems are to be basically modeled, predicted, and what are the things that can be done for these extreme weather events to be monitored. So now I'll be talking about the observation things that, or the modeling studies that we are, basically the atmospheric activities that we are having at Aries Nainital. So we do micrometeorological observations here, which is utilized for the studies of the boundary layer dynamics and the lowermost portion of this troposphere, say within few hundred meters to about 1 to 2 kilometer. Then we have trace gas measurements, as we were talking about in the initial slides, that we have to monitor all these trace gas measurements, and so we have one group also working on that, one scientist, and then we also do aerosol measurements, surface aerosol measurements, vertical profiling also, then of course satellite based studies also we carry out here, and of course these modeling opportunities are also there, and then we have a big facility in the atmospheric science we called a stratospheric tropospheric radar system. So these are the kind of opportunities where if the young students who are interested to do their research or pursue their present in the atmospheric science, they can also be associated with these activities and they can explore in more details. So this is basically a tower we have put here. At two levels, 12 meter and the 27 meters, we have two sonic anemometers which give us the information about the all three component of the wind, which are very, very essential for understanding the vertical structure or the basically the mixing of these pollutants or the energy, mass, momentum, anything from the surface of the earth. And at the surface we have flux plates for the outgoing radiation, and we have other soil flux measurements associated with this, of course the radiation measurements as well. And if you see, these are the results from the sonic anemometers in the March, April and May. If we see at this mountain site, we have high wind conditions, basically going up to sometime 10 to 12 meter per second in the summer months, and direction remains almost same. It's either westerly to northwesterly, somewhere between 270 degree to 360 is basically northwesterly winds at this location, and then temperature also is going up to about 24, 26 degrees Celsius. So these are some of the observations just to give you a feel that how we make the atmospheric measurements. And then in winter season, because the seasons, different seasons, we have different kind of solar radiation and the associated atmospheric winds. And in winter, if you see that the winds are quite low, you know, their winds were going up to 10 to 12 meter per second. But here, if you see, the most of the time are less than 5 meter per second. So we call these low wind conditions, and then direction also is not that consistent what we were seeing in the summer season. So the direction changes from, say, north to again coming back to the north. So it, there is a huge cycle of directions going back 180 and changing from morning to evening. So this is following basically the sun. So it means when their winds are very low, the wind direction is very much localized. It is not governed by the mean flow, and it is governed by the heating of the mountains from the solar radiation. The side which is being heated, the wind starts blowing towards that side. So this is a very interesting feature that we have over mountains and part of the mountain meteorology. Now again, we have a LIDAR system to monitor the vertical extent of the pollutants or the particles, basically aerosols, which goes up into the atmosphere. So this is a LIDAR system we were having, and now we are in the process to upgrade it. But then, I mean, we have some information which we have generated using this system, and I'll be talking about that also. So if you see that this is a typical profile that we observe with the LIDAR system, you know, here there are two different curves, you can say. This is after monsoon, and this is during, just before monsoon, you can see. It is a very old data. So here you see that you will not find the kind of layers you are able to see here. So here, this implies that the mixing of the pollutants, or we can say that the aerosols has gone up to, say, about, this is from mean sea level, so around more than 1 kilometer. 2, 3, 4, 5, so up to, we can say, 1.5 kilometer in the atmosphere. And the same when all these pollutants are washed out by the monsoon, this is a typical day, you can see we are very clean and we do not have these aerosols or the pollutants in the atmosphere. And these are some more observations. If you see that in different season, particularly in summer, we have these pollutants going up to as high as up to 4.5 kilometer in the atmosphere. And then again, so in the monsoon, if you see, it goes out. So basically, the rains clean the atmosphere. Again, the effect of these fires, basically, these dots are the fires, fire counts, which are taken from the satellite observations, derived from the satellite observations. If you see that this Haryana and Punjab region is mostly in winter time, we have lot of stubble burning and then crop residual burning in that region, and this is quite often captured by the satellite observations. And these pollutants also sometime travel towards the Himalayan region, and we are able to see them here also. And this is done with the ground-based measurements as well as these vertical profiling of these radar system, LIDAR systems. Again, if you see here, there is no pollutant in between these two layers, and suddenly we see a layer around 2 kilometer just in the up in the atmosphere. So this layer is basically not of the local origin, so this is coming from somewhere else. So again, there are atmospheric phenomenon that we need to understand and work for how we can, you know, we can utilize these informations for the future modeling and forecasting issues. So here you can see that these are the North African deserts, where red means these are dust column mass density is very, very high. So these are the dust regions, hot spots for dust, and from these regions we will draw back trajectory. We are able to see that the trajectory analysis is able to show this dust is even sometime reaching from the North African continent to the Indian Himalayan region. So this is one information that we have from the observations from Aries. Another thing that as we are talking about the transport of the pollutants, particle pollutants in the form of the dust and other smaller particles which are less than 2.5 micron in the diameter, these also are transport and get transported with any sort of the storms which are approaching to the Himalayan region. And again, then we have a instrument, very small and portable instrument, handheld. Even you can put it on, connect it to your mobile and put it in your pocket also. We have installed one in such instrument at Aries, and it gives us the level of measurements on the level of the particulate matter of the order of which are less than or equal to 2.5 micron, which is very, very severe pollutant in terms of air quality if we talk about. And mostly it has a huge issue in the summer times that, or winter time, that particulate matter PM2.5 has gone beyond say 600 and 700 in Delhi. But then the permissible limits of different countries is somewhere between 30 microgram per meter cube to 50 microgram. But if you see in Delhi, their quality index or these particulate, the concentration of the particulate matter by default is beyond 50 microgram per meter cube. So over Nainital, as compared to Delhi, if you see 2 years of the observations, we are hardly approaching up to 40 microgram per meter cube at occasions, but then mostly we are within say 30 to 40 microgram per meter cube. Now we have one big facility which is operational and being operated in common mode operations at Aries Nainital. We call as stratospheric tropospheric radar. As we were talking about that, there are different layers, 4 layers of the atmosphere extending up to 600 kilometer, and we have to have information about that. Then we have to basically have some ground-based remote sensing devices, which is one of them. Our ST radar is one of them, and this is capable of giving you the wind profiles in the vertical up to about 20 kilometer. The system is designed for 20 kilometer, and then we can study number of atmospheric phenomenon or atmospheric processes using this radar. We send an electromagnetic signal at 206.5 into the atmosphere using all these phased array antenna. This is basically a assembly of phased array antenna put on the rooftop of 30 by 30 meter, and we are having 12 clusters of each 49 elements, and then these are given some phase gradient, and these form a beam which is transmitted up into the atmosphere. And then beam is also switchable in five directions, basically east, west, north, south, and vertical. We can point in any of these directions and then get the wind profiles, and from that wind profiles and basically the return echo, from that we can derive many other things. So these are the atmospheric phenomenon that we can study with these radars. And this is basically one component we call transmit receive module, which is just below this roof. On the rooftop we have antenna, and then below this, these transmit receive module along with the power supplies are hanged, and these transmit our signal towards the antenna, and antenna radiates into the atmosphere. And this is how, you know, as I was telling, that we can get the information from all five directions: north, south, east, west, and zenith, basically overhead vertical. And this is power density plot. If you see, this power density is basically the backscattered power, and along, and Doppler shift also. This power corresponding a Doppler, this is a power is basically corresponding a Doppler shift. So this, from that Doppler shift, we determine the velocity of the target. Target is basically the atmosphere. Now there are, as I was telling, that various challenges in the atmospheric science even today. And Ministry of Earth Sciences have set 11 institutes for monitoring the atmosphere, ocean, and even the seismic activities, dedicated to one institution. And for atmospheric science and meteorology, if we talk about, these are basically the big organizations. You can say the India Meteorological Department is having center in almost all states and district places. And then IITM is another big center which is having all climate modeling facilities, observing facilities, many sites. So we have number of opportunities and in these institutes. And then the other is which is mostly dedicated for the atmospheric modeling, weather forecasting, we call it National Center for Medium Range Weather Forecasting. So weather forecasting is also at various levels. I mean, we can say that can we predict any small scale weather phenomenon, say 2 days in advance? So that is again a challenge. So these are the challenges, and then opportunities lies with these institutions. And if you want to browse more through these institutes, so you can go to the website of the Ministry of Earth Sciences. There you will find all institutes which are fully dedicated for the atmospheric and oceanic related research and observations. Then of course IIT is also having some departments in IITs and ICERs, like environmental sciences, civil engineering, physics. They are also having one component of the atmospheric sciences. There also students can be, you know, associated and find out some opportunities for them for projects, masters or PhDs. So that's how we can, you know, explore the thing, the opportunities for us. There are a number of opportunities abroad in the universities abroad as well in the field of the meteorology. Now the challenges, as I told, that we have to model the various atmospheric processes precisely and well in advance, which is again a big challenge. And then there are various schemes inside the models also, which may be working very good for one geographical location and one at one latitude, because the circulations and the weather patterns or over different latitudes are different. So then the same models or the scheme may not be working for like Himalayan region or the complex topographical regions. And then of course climate model is again a big challenge, because it takes huge amount of data for long observations, and as precise and as good the observations are, so we will be able to model the climate of the future. Then meteorological processes over complex terrain is again altogether very different situation. If we want to model these processes, we have to make the measurements over these regions, and then understand those processes, and then of course implement all those processes in the modeling schemes. That is another important point and a challenging issue, because mostly the researchers are working on the kind of flat terrains or the other plain regions basically, and these complex topographical regions are very difficult to monitor, because the topography changes within say 50 meter to 100 meter. So these are again challenges. The forecasting that extreme weather events is, as I told, that big challenge, that we do not have much time in hand to, you know, kind of get it information about in advance and then react to it. So these are very as I told, that in Himalayan region cloud burst is a very severe event, and we do not have even a chance to escape if all such activities happen. So again, forecasting and modeling of these extreme weather events is a challenge. So, and then setting the high density network for observation, of course, is the need of the day, and this is again big challenge for kind of the agencies which are the responsibility which lie with. And then these are setups or the experiments, or we can measurement tools we can set up in various regions, which I understand basically, if we have to monitor all these small scale phenomenon like surface meteorological parameters, of course AWS, all these are very essential nowadays, and we have good number of stations in India, but still for modeling purposes we need a dense network of these. Then radio sound measurements, cloud measurements using radars, accelerometers, and then of course clear air radars we also need to have for the vertical profiling of the winds, cloud radars we need, Doppler weather radars, satellite measurements, and high resolution modeling ultimately. So these all tools are to be set up in, one location, so that and at a very high resolution, which involves a lot of cost implications as well. But then this is the only way if we have to improve significantly the weather forecast and the atmospheric monitoring. So we have to have such networks having all sort of measurements at one place. So this is in context of basically the kind of events that we witness in the Himalayan region. So that's all from my side, and thanks for listening patiently. Questions, please. So this has to be right. So if someone misses today's live lecture, they can find it on ARI's Facebook page and also on ARI's YouTube channel. So please subscribe to our YouTube channel, and the links to these sites are available on ARI's official website. So you can also submit your questions later, and also provide your feedback by using link available below the videos.